Hey everybody, welcome back to Garuda. Today I'm going to be working on some detailing around the gardens that Rudi has made in the last episode, and I'm not the biggest expert on the gardens that he's made, but he's traveled to Thailand and he's made some awesome Thailand inspired gardens. So Rudi, why don't you say hi and tell us a little bit more about them?
Yeah, hey everybody, here I'm back on your channel. I'm so happy that you're going to continue with this garden, because honestly, guys, last time we had no idea how to continue, and this time, because I have to be quite honest about this, I just went into the garden because I wanted to do, and I just gave it to Sylv, and he had no other choice to build on that. So I'm pretty happy to see how he's doing now. But in terms of the garden, it's a garden. Basically, it's a garden. It's nothing too special about a garden, but it's a little bit about the feeling you have when you think of, for example, being in holidays, and then you've been traveled to such a country which you are not too used to, like for example these kind of jungle looks and stuff like this. And so that was really why I was so impressed by these gardens, like how they were laid out and how all these exotic plants work together with pretty common plants, which are maybe not that common in their area, but for me they kind of are used. I just know about all these plants, but they work pretty well together with all these foliage which you would expect over there. And so this is basically one thing about the garden in general. But something else which is also very interesting is that you kind of have a difference between gardens that kind of grew naturally and gardens that have been laid out for purpose. This is definitely one which has been laid out for purpose. And it's kind of interesting to see also how Planet Coaster gives us possibilities to do gardens, because I think that's not something which we've been too much into, right?
I think it's more like
a gap filler kind of.
Yeah,
stuff.
You're definitely right there. I think personally though, using foliage just as a filler is a very common pitfall actually, and like I don't think every part of an area should be filled with foliage. Like it's not like you don't have grass anywhere in your park. I think you should really treat your foliage as something to enhance rather than just to fill in the empty spots of your park. What I also thought was very interesting now that you just commented on it is, I'm no expert on Thai gardens or anything, I've never been there, but I've done a lot of searching on the internet and see what they look like. And one thing which kind of struck me, and I'm not really sure how right I am with this, but they seem a little bit Western to me, or at least some of those flower and palace gardens seem, in a sense that if you take, for instance, Japanese gardens, which are very East Asian in their style, that they're very not human. They are completely planned, but they're made to be as natural and as laid back and as subtle as they can be. Whereas these gardens feel very man-made and very much more abstract, and with all of these patterns that you don't see in nature at all. I thought that was something very interesting and something which you really see in the garden here as well.
Yeah, I think that's something I could comment on, but I think it's really, really a tough thing to talk about because I'm not an expert at all. But kind of the feeling I had is that maybe also the kind of, it's not a cultural thing in general, but kind of how the king of Thailand has been planned all of this, or in this case, as we've been told in the comments as well, the queen. It's really something which comes from the royals and from all these, organized people who just went there and built pretty big gardens for tourism, for example, as well, and also for people there. And I think that in general Thailand is a little bit more Western oriented than Japan or like China, also they are not that much into Western style, and Thailand kind of is. And also in Bangkok you kind of see the influence of Western architecture and stuff like this, and I think this is kind of a result of the orientation toward Western style in general of Thailand, because I don't want to comment on if the king was the king's reign was good or not good for the people, because there are two different, completely different opinions about this within Thailand, and I don't want to actually go into this. But one thing you can't deny is that he's really modern, and his reign was really modern. He was really using technique and technology and stuff like this, and he also planned projects like this, like a lot of them. And I think this is kind of the influence of those kind of modern lifestyle he brought into his country. Apart from this, you will also find some really beautiful man-made gardens that don't seem to be man-made. They are also naturally looking, but they are kind of more like in really in the countryside of Thailand.
Oh yeah, that's a really good point. Yeah, I definitely get more of like the palace, large flowery gardens from yours, which I also kind of want to say very quickly to the viewers. In this episode, I'll be mostly just adding detailing and making small things, also doing some of the supports of the coaster, because many of them were left behind because of the path being quite close to it. But I'll be doing mostly detailing and adding all kinds of smaller and texture-related things into the park. And Rudi in the last episode really just laid the entire groundwork of what the park is, what the gardens are looking like, and what they are laid out like. So I'm not really doing anything big or structural in that sense. I just figured that what Rudy's already done in the last episode is a brilliant layout that I don't think I want to mess with, and I'm just trying to add as much as I can, all kinds of details that can make it maybe not just a bit nicer, but also fit in a bit more with what we already had.
Yeah, and I guess as far as I see this, you did a pretty well, a brilliant job there. And also, I think this gives the coaster a really immersive kind of style towards the last part of the layout so far. So like before it's going into the break run, it's really the last part of it going through the little gardens and stuff like this, which gives it a really nice feel to the coaster, and it's close to the ground, so it kind of feels... it still feels pretty fast, and then, but it really goes like really naturally through all these gardens, and you've got different parts to look at, and I think this really is a good thing to do now, so we have just kind of the possibility to see in the future what we can also add to the whole area to give it maybe two different areas, like the really gardening stuff and maybe something else on the other side. So I'm really happy with how it turns out so far.
Yeah, exactly. I actually had no idea what this was going to look like either. And I want to thank you for making like the entire layout of the gardens. Because it's sometimes when you're on your own, and I don't know if you can relate to this, but it's hard to get outside of the box. It's hard to get that small box which confines you and really step out of it, because there's no real box that confines you. But in a sense, and this is going to sound so weird now that I'm saying it, but in a sense, if you get somebody else who places that box onto you, who gives you something which is completely different than what you would have done, and you need to work around it, it can make you a lot more creative. And I don't think I could have come up with a garden layout that works so well with the coaster layout that I already had. Like, I probably would have made everything a lot flatter and more boring. And now that I have that kind of thing, which I wouldn't have done myself, I don't know, it just gives you some interesting stuff to build your details around in ways that you wouldn't see coming before it. So there's like a little pond next to the station with some water and some rocks and flowers around it, and it's something which I myself would have never put in that position, but you kind of like nudged it there, and like I can add the detail. I think that's just a really funny thing, like the way in which you can make each other a bit more creative by giving each other things that are maybe challenging to what you would otherwise do yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like, it's really funny that you're going really into this kind of topic now, because you do know, but the guys out there don't know. I'm just coming back from university today, and it's a really theoretical thing, but it's also like really kind of the whole thing, how creativity works in teams, you know, like in an advertising agency. That's what you just explained there is kind of the best case you can have in an agency, like people giving positive information to each other and then grow their creativity upon this exchange of information, which is basically really important to know also for the future, because every information you get outside from other people, which is kind of not your own thought, but it's something which you get from the outside, it's so important to just deal with it in the right way. And I think this is what defines creativity, to be able to just grab those informations. And I mean, in the end, to be, it's really, as I said, I'm just coming back from university, so it's really theoretical, but in a way the park I gave you is just kind of an information for you in the original part of it. It's just an information, and what you do in the end is kind of you grab that information and you transfer it into your own kind of style, and mm-hmm. then you do something new with it. And in the next part, it's kind of the information which I take from you. So it's really basic stuff, basic theoretical stuff. But I think this is how creativity in general works, and how people and humanity in general just gets to the point where we are at the moment. Like, grabbing information from all over the place and doing hopefully the best with it.
Yeah, I think that's actually a really amazing point. It's also what I always felt makes a game like Planet Coaster as good as it is, at least in bringing people together and not making everyone salty like games like League of Legends might probably do, in that you are kind of building on other people's things. And even if you would say that the best projects in Planet Coaster are not the ones that are built as collaborations, but just the ones that are built by people themselves on their own, I think you cannot deny that communities and games in general, like Planet Coaster, kind of thrive on that community interaction in order to get better. So, for instance, I'll upload a video and use this trick to make better supports for my coaster, and other people can pick that up and like further improve on it, and everybody just kind of builds on each other in a community that way. And that's kind of how we go from building a Grizzly Valley and a crude Space Mountain a couple months ago when this game was just launched, exactly. to making the things that we're making in the game right now. It's, I mean, I don't want to discredit the developers in any way. There's definitely so many new things as well, but I think there's an inventiveness to a community like Planet Coaster, which has to rely on the other people in the community to get better at the game, that you don't really find in games which are competitive or which don't have that kind of feedback.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's also, and maybe it defines this genre of simulation games and creative games in general, because if you just take a first-person shooter, I mean, you can just watch other people play the game and just admit that they are pretty fucking good in it, and
yeah,
not. But anyway, it doesn't really help you. And I mean, it's like about practice, you know. Most of this is like about practice, and a little bit of talent to be good in reflexes and stuff like this. But kind of in Planet Coaster, it's really. It's not, I won't say it's simple in all times, but like you all have different talents and you can use them, and you can just grab the ideas from others to use them in really spectacular and amazing ways. Because I've also posted it in a Facebook group just the later days, just to tell people that they're doing amazing stuff, because I've seen so many great creations over the last couple of weeks, which I would have never thought of. Like in the workshop there are so many great stuff. There's so many great stuff which is blowing me away, just because, not maybe because of the amount of detail, because these ideas are so simple but genius at the same time. And yeah, that's really something about the genre, about the community. And I really have to say I love the community about Planet Coaster, and especially, but also about these simulation games. It's amazing.
Mm-hmm. Actually, kind of on that topic, did you see the latest Star Wars coaster that somebody made? I don't remember who made it. I'll put it in the description because I know where to find it.
Please do. I have to laugh because you know this kind of screenshot I've shown you the later days with this really nice comment I got on my videos?
I kind of remember, but I don't really
This was this guy. And he was writing me a private message, and we were like chatting about it, and he told me, well, I did something there, a coaster, can you tell me if it's good or not? And he was showing me the first beta version of it, and I was like, dude, why are you asking me? This is kind of a freaking amazing coaster which I wouldn't have come up with. I mean, like, who am I to tell you if that's good or not?
Exactly. It's like straight down way better than what we did with the Death Star coaster.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, like, the best part of it is really like how he's done the light speed effect.
Yeah.
It's like, what? I mean, like, it's so nicely done. Mm-hmm. And it's so simple. If you think about it, you in a second, you get the idea how it's done. But you've never thought of it before. And it's like, yeah, I get this, but...
Exactly. And it's not like you have to practice... For years for it, I guess. I saw the tutorial today and it was just like, oh well, I just hung some fairy lights over here and put that together in a pattern, and now it looks like you're traveling through space, and it's just so cool.
Yeah, amazing. And as I said, he put down this amazing comment there, and it felt like really strange that he was asking me about this, because like, to be honest, I'm also not an expert about coasters. Maybe in building stuff I can give some advices, but I'm just starting to go more into coasters, and that's basically the best example that we now come up with him, because we didn't talk about it before, mm-hmm. and now we have exactly this video, which I was also so freaking amazed about, because it's like, yeah, as we said, he wasn't known before, you know, he hasn't had a big YouTube channel or something like this, or he kind of wasn't somebody who's always posting in the community, but he kind of got all the information he can get from the workshop and stuff like this, and he came up with this brilliant coaster. And it's not just a coaster, it's a whole experience, and it's so nicely done. And I have to say, I'm so much looking forward to more of this, because I'm pretty sure we will be blown away like each week.
Yeah, I was just about to say, because it's kind of a dark ride. It's not technically a dark ride, but it's an indoor coaster with dark ride effects.
Yeah.
I will love to see more dark rides or indoor coasters of that sort in Planet Coaster, because it's one of my favorite things. I am trying to do a little bit in it, but that's a bit big stage, and not sure how well those experiments are going to pan out, but it's something which I haven't really seen that much, but I think it's an area where there's a lot of potential for this game.
Yeah, I'm also working on one, but I don't know when to finish it, but I'm working on that one from the first Camel Kingdom episode, but I've mm-hmm. seen so much great stuff that I just step back a little bit from this project for the moment, because I was just, as we said, I was just gathering more information about how to do it to make it really good. And this is really, I really lost the words how to explain that, but I think if there is anybody out there complaining about too less content, I will just give you this little thought. I'm pretty sure that before the big update in April, we won't have seen everything which is possible with the current build. And I'm not talking about like layouts or stuff like this. I mean about like the ideas people come up with. And when there is the new new update, we will get so much new stuff. And there's even more stuff people can be creative with. And so this will be growing the game so much that we don't have to talk about too less content at the moment. Because mm-hmm. we are far, far away from having experienced everything we can. And this is also, it's not just about playing the game yourself, it's also about seeing what others can do, and there we have a lot to come.
Yeah, it's crazy. It is kind of like an art form, though I want to be very careful about this. This is not a discussion I want to get into too much, because I've had this in the past with like people who think that games like these are an art. I remember Fluxtrance at some point saying a couple of years ago that Roller Coaster Tycoon 3 was art, and I was heavily disagreeing with him, but I think in a certain way they definitely are, or at least they're a creative sort of outlet, much in the way that painting and music can be, because it gets you in the same kind of collaborative, creative mood, which I think is very interesting about it. And yeah, about the updates, I definitely will admit that the game is very shallow right now, and to be honest, I really, really want to have more content in here, but then at the same time, I'm also just impatient, I guess, because this is supposed to be a long support game with some future things coming out. And if you look at games like, well, Roller Coaster Tycoon 1 or Roller Coaster Tycoon 3, they didn't have that much content in the beginning either, and much of it really came in expansions. So we'll see how all that's going to pan out.
Yeah, I'm absolutely not saying that we have enough. So it's just like we haven't seen all of it. And I'm totally agreeing on this point. And I also have to say, dude, I absolutely know about this discussions, because we didn't have it with kind of computer games, but we had such a big discussion about if advertising is art or be art. And this is also a discussion which, it actually wouldn't find an end. And I think it's all down to perspective, and I also don't want to go too much into it, because this is also something which can people go into if they are interested, but be careful, you will be lost.
Exactly. I still feel like the best way to put art is that it's anything which people see as art is art. And that's pretty much the most simple way, because in a very crude way, anything that's man-made is art in a sense, because anything that someone makes is some kind of form of expression and some kind of creative thing.
Yeah, I really feel we are going into really
this is super kind of deep. Jesus. Oh wow. Yeah.
I was like, I felt like I'm going back to Planet Coaster now after university, but I have no idea if we've been that deep today in university.
That's crazy.
It's fine. It's fine.
Everyone's getting a free course on YouTube videos today. But yeah, actually, I'm just working on the tea house right now, which is not that interesting. I know you were kind of hyped about it, but it's just a simple little wooden tea house because there was this area where there was nothing left anymore. So just building a simple wooden tea house inspired by some images that I found on Google Images, because I had no reference to go by when it comes to these kinds of buildings, so I'm just kind of improvising.
You really nailed it. Yeah, I mean, I've seen the final result, and I have to say it's really, really great, because I've just been to one tea house in Thailand, to be honest. I have to say it really reminds me in a way. And
oh, wow.
That's good.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's, yeah. So I didn't want to interrupt you too much on this, but I really had to say that.
Oh, I don't even remember anymore what my entire tangent was going on about anymore. I am very serious about that, actually. I don't have a clue what I was going to say. I still have no idea. The one thing that I did kind of think about that my mind was still set on is that you told me that you were kind of looking into roller coasters more recently. So
I
actually got some comments recently, like, I was afraid that my roller coaster nerd talk was bringing people down in my videos, and they were like, what are you even talking about? Why are you doing this? Please don't submit this to our viewing pleasures, because it's terrible. But apparently some people actually want me to nerd more about roller coasters somehow, which I guess is pretty cool. But this is an RMC coaster, and I haven't really talked about it much, but I wonder how much you know about these things right now, because you said you kind of looked into companies, or at least their histories and stuff. And like, how much do you know about the hybrid coasters in here?
Yeah, I do actually know a lot about this, because the first thing I was looking up where I can freaking ride this stuff.
Oh, yes.
the first thing I found out is, well, not close to us, right? And then I went a little bit more deep into it, and there, if I'm correct, there are just about 8 running at the moment on the whole planet. So
I thought it's a little higher, but I'm not sure.
It 8 might or be 9 that. Something like that. I'm not too sure about it, but there are more planned, of course. But also there's none planned near us here in Europe, and this is kind of something which I was really sad about, because I watched a lot of YouTube videos about them, and also I found one in virtual reality, and I tried it out with my virtual reality glasses, which I don't own myself, which I have from our company. they're a little bit faster than normal wooden coasters would be, and kind of these crazy banked turns and just quick curves and stuff like this really gets a really nice feeling, and I don't want to tell too much about the experience, because I never had it in real life, but I could really, I could tell that this should be a really great experience.
Yeah,
because it's so fast and close to the ground, and then these really crazy bank turns which throw you a little bit through the entire build of the park. This is kind of
exactly, that's how I feel about them as well. They seem like one of the most amazing coasters to ever ride. I know that Americans are probably going to flood the comments here, because America is full of these things, and be like, yes, you have to ride them someday. There is one in Europe. I don't know if you know about that one, Wildfire in Sweden.
Oh, no, I didn't find that.
There is one in Sweden. However, a couple of months ago, it was closed because of environmental reasons. And then there were a lot of rumors that it was going to be demolished, but I actually heard today that apparently it's not going to get demolished, and there were some reports that it's going to stand there, not operating. I don't know any other news, though, so I'd be super happy to hear about it, but it's actually one of the best in the world, generally, considered to at least be one of the best in the world, but they're all good. But basically, it was closed for environmental reasons, but apparently they're not demolishing it, so that's good news, and I really hope it's going to open sometime again, because it's the only hybrid we have in Europe, and it's a really amazing one at that. And it would be amazing to ride it at some point in my life, because this is the one kind of coaster that I would love to ride, but just don't have the opportunity to.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, that's basically the reason why I didn't find it, because I was just looking for operating ones.
And oh, yeah.
I'm just looking for them for a few weeks. To be honest, I said to you, and it's completely honest, it's down to your videos, because it was like the first videos I've seen, you talking nerd stuff about coasters. I was like, okay, great. I do understand what he's doing there, but I have no idea what he's talking about. And I do want to understand what he's talking about. Mm-hmm. So I want to go into it. And first thing was to learn all of these abbreviations, to understand which company you are fucking talking about. And the thing was, you were talking about this like so, as if it would be so normal to know about everything like this. And I was kind of feeling stupid because I didn't actually know what in general. And then I was like, okay, I'm not going to tell this, but I'm now going into this as well. Mm-hmm. And so because I'm a curious person in general. So this is great. I mean, like, it's, I'm doing that for pleasure, and it's a lot of pleasure to watch coaster videos. So I'm not going to tell you that it's bad that you actually drove me into looking more into coasters.
Oh yeah, I think it's pretty awesome. At least it's something I hope to do with my videos at some point as well, because it was actually Rollercoaster Tycoon 3 that got me into it, and that eventually got me into actually liking riding them as well, because I was actually afraid of riding them before. And only actually got over that afraidness of coasters this summer, and then I just got instantly hooked. So there's a story that some people might know, but many people probably don't know yet. So yeah, I think it's actually very interesting how it can make you interested in roller coasters in general, and I'm kind of proud of myself that I got you into it. Or maybe I am not that proud for making you waste your own time looking them up, but hey, as long as you enjoy doing it.
Yeah, well, don't mind, because there would be anything else which I would be looking into, which might people understand as wasting time. So this is fine. I'm kind of the generation, and I think as you are as well, I'm curious, and so the internet gets me into
Like the Wikipedia generation, where you're just like, what about this random thing, and just go on the internet and you can find out about it, and you can just read it. You read about it for hours, it's crazy. It's actually
it's like the link really game, strange. You know? Click this link and oh no, I'm going to this link and this link and this.
Yep.
Yeah. You actually know about this game? We made
the Wikipedia game?
Yeah.
Yeah, where it's like you have to end up at a certain thing, and you go to a random page, and you have to make sure that by clicking on the hyperlinks you get to that like a goal that you set. Yeah, it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, we did this in school. That was the only cool thing in school we did about the internet, which was really
Because if the people are going to walk into the computer room or into the classroom, you're going to be like, hey, look, I'm on Wikipedia. I'm doing school stuff.
Yeah, that's it. Like, this was the only tab which was opened to be meant to be opened.
Oh, you never had those Word files in the back where you're just playing games, and as soon as you hear somebody approaching, you're like, L tab to Word. I mean, that works pretty well.
Like, yeah, of course, that was the case. And the first time we actually put Counter-Strike 1.6 on a USB drive. This was the day where school changed. it was fucking amazing. But I don't know when I was. I think after the 10th grade or so, I didn't have that any longer because it was so stupidly boring and I didn't learn anything in this. And yeah, I think it's the same nowadays, and I'm a little bit afraid of people going to school and don't learn anything about the usage of the internet. I'm really looking into doing more in the future to help people in school to get into this.
That's an entirely different topic, but that's a very good point. Definitely, there's a lot of stuff that, you know, people learn in schools that we shouldn't learn, and there's a lot of stuff, like, especially new media related things that you should probably learn in school that people don't learn.
Yes, definitely. I mean, it's a hard topic to go into, but I have to say, we are working on kind of a project for the university as well, how to help schools. But it's, there are so many factors that are kind of the reason for schools having those kind of issues. And it's really difficult. I thought it would have been easier to solve those problems, to be honest.
Reality is always very complicated. Yep. Anyway, how did we even get there from a planet coaster talk? Jesus.
I actually don't know.
That's crazy. This has probably been one of my favorite commentaries of all time. Just super deep. I'm sorry it wasn't perhaps more surface level talk about what I'm doing in game, but it's just detailing and placing shrubs and rocks and that kind of stuff. Figured it would be just more interesting to just talk about whatever, but this has been more or less it for the time-lapse, so I want to thank you guys so much for watching, and next time, I guess we're going to be on Rudi's channel again, right?
Yeah, I think so.
All right.
I have no idea what to do, but yeah, we are on my channel at least.
I guess we'll figure something out. Anyway, yeah. Next week, we're going to be back, and we're going to be doing something which we don't know yet quite what it is exactly going to be. So see you guys in the next video.